Hello and welcome to JavaScript Marathon Training presented by This.Labs. My name is Sarah Renault with This.Labs and I will be your host. On our Angular track today, we will learn why the async pipe is boring. Fully zoneless, high performance, and post-Ivy aims to help you understand the guts of Angular's change detection and why Zone.js is your biggest enemy. Our trainer today is Michael Latke, consultant, trainer, MVP, GDE in Angular, and lead instructor at Trilon. Welcome to JavaScript Marathon, Michael.
Hello. Also welcome. Thanks, Sarah, for the intro.
You're welcome. Feel free to reach out to Michael on Twitter using the handle shown at the bottom of the screen. Mm-hmm. If you have any questions or feedback, please don't hesitate to get in touch. JavaScript Marathon would not be possible without our sponsors. Our sponsor today is This.Labs, your partners in modern digital transformation. We specialize in mentorship, consulting, training, and staff augmentation for enterprise organizations. Find out more at this.labs.com or send us an email at hi@this.co. Do you find keeping up with the constantly evolving technologies a struggle? Do you want to bring your team up to speed on one of the latest technologies? This.Labs offers personalized training programs to suit your organizational needs, ensuring you and your company stay on the leading edge. Contact us today at hi@this.co to set up your complimentary needs assessment. Tune in every first Thursday of the month for our global Angular meetup. This.Labs online meetups are an amazing opportunity for developers and enthusiasts alike to engage with the global tech community no matter where they are in the world. Register at angularmeetup.com. And with that, I'll turn it over to Michael.
Thanks, Sarah. So let me start and share my screen. Let me quickly check the time. You already heard it. The async pipe is boring. And I want to start with the slide deck here with fully zoneless, high-performance Angular applications in post-Ivy. What can we do after we move to Ivy? And here, I don't want to waste time and I straight go to the agenda. I will introduce you to rendering in general. It will be maybe a quick introduction. Maybe you will learn a little bit of pieces of new information. And to demonstrate all the things that are implemented in the demos, I have to explain some core concepts to you. And one of those two core concepts is scheduling. And another core concept is coalescing. And with those two concepts implemented in code, I will present a lot of demos how you can get cutting edge performance, even with zone included. And I guess this is the really cool part. And I hope I will have enough time for all the demos. So let's start with Angular rendering, and I will give you a theoretical introduction into how template rendering works in the component tree. So if you look to the right, this is a very small zoom in or zoom out of the application that I will theoretically discuss. And the next slide is a wireframe. And we can see one blue box and a lot of green boxes. The blue box is a Angular service, which is called application reference. And all the green boxes are our components that we use to display our side menu and list items at whatever we see here. And displayed in a tree structure, it would look like this. We have the application reference that holds the main component, which in turn is connected to all its children, which in turn have children and children and so on. And by default, now I remove all the information about what children it is, by default rendering could look something like that. There is a apref tick called and nothing happened so far. And after the application ref tick is done, we start with rendering our components top to bottom. Please excuse the small animation error here. So the left block, the ref, the right bottom block here in the slides should get green at the end. But this is basically how rendering works from top to bottom. And we all know that this is the Angular default way of rendering the full application. There is another thing that is called change detection on push. And if you look at this small gray triangle, this is my symbol for the change detection. If there is a change detected, if there is a difference to the previous value or not. And in this case, only this component has change detection on push. Now let's run the rendering again and let's see what happens this time. We see the first one is rendered and then the evaluation over the change detection strategy on push is done. And we see that there is no change to the left side of this component tree, only to the right side. So I will stop rendering the left side and only render the right side. And here we see that our item list and all the items get re-rendered, but not the stuff that was not really involved in this change. So this is what the async pipe is. And in practice, you say, okay, let's use the async pipe everywhere. This is basically the solution to our performance issues. And maybe you can also implement some linter rules that you are enforced to use it. But in practice, it looks a little bit different. If you take a look at the purple or let's say pink box here, this is the stuff I want to update. And if I run Angular natively, all the yellow boxes would also re-render in a more or less real-life application, right? I have always the process that I go top to bottom and start to render it down from the very bottom, from the very top. And I have also components where change detection strategy is on default, maybe because I forgot it, or maybe I used some third-party component that took not care about all those details. So this is the reality. And let me quickly introduce myself and then a solution to this clumsy reality. My name is Michael Latke. As Sarah already introduced me, I'm lead instructor at Trilon, self-employed consultant, GD and MVP, and I'm very active in the community, especially in exploring cutting edge things like, for example, rendering performance in PostIVY, which is, I guess, a pretty exciting thing. Speaking about rendering performance and so on, I did a lot of contributions already in the past to NGRX, and they released two components, the push pipe and the let directive, and all my future contributions will move the really, really nice stuff and the stuff that brings us the zoneless performance in the package RX Angular. So if you want to keep up with further things, RX Angular is the package you should check out. In RX Angular, I use principles to introduce all those performance optimizations. And one of those principles is scheduling. Scheduling basically moves a block of code that would get executed at a specific time into another task stack or also into the future many seconds, for example. And I will quickly introduce you to flame charts. This is a crash course now. flame charts consist out of purple and green boxes, and they tell you stuff, all the information about what your browser and how much work is your browser doing to compress all the layers together and render the latest DOM state. And you have this green dashed line here. This is a very interesting spot. This is right before the browser paints all the changes to your DOM. You should know that painting DOM is the most expensive thing you can have beside all the stuff that are related to loading. But at runtime, this is like one of the main things you should take care of. And if I run a synchronous task, a flame chart could look like this. I have some trigger, for example, a button click. This is the yellow part. And then some code is executing. And then my specific function, and I marked the specific function here with a lot of X's in a row because it's easier for me to spot. And this is executed immediately after the click, as you can see. So this is a synchronous task, and now let me talk a little bit about a trigger and what work is, because scheduling is all about moving work onto another place in the event loop. in the browser event loop. So the top part here, the yellow thing, is like my button is clicked, I have the callback listener on the click handler, and then I execute my custom function, for example, increment or my XXX function here. And this is the trigger that should execute my work. And the second part of the code here is this XXX, this small function, and as you can see a little bit bigger on the right side, is the work that I want to schedule, that I want to try to move to another place in the event loop. And scheduling in a whole basically looks like this. I click a button, I take this function, and instead of executing it immediately, I move it into another part of my event loop. And here I have two interesting areas, before the green dashed line or after the green dashed line. Roughly speaking, everything before the green dashed line is something that should be interesting for the user, everything or that is visible, and everything after the green line is something that is maybe not that interesting for the user, but still requires some work to do. For example, HTTP request, the user will not see when an HTTP request is fired. And this is scheduling. Scheduling is a concept that I will leverage a couple of times in a different way. The first time is I will leverage it to implement coalescing. This is the second principle that I want to explain. And the other part is that I want to use it to increase the performance drastically. So let's give a quick overview. I have a lot of different opportunities to schedule a task somewhere else. The red line is synchronous, yellow is a macro task, and then I have macro task. And here I also included idle callback, which is maybe a little bit experimental. And I have also cutting edge things that are not yet really released from the Grom Canary, the post task scheduling API. And these are all the blue arrows. So just that you see, this is the collection we can use to introduce some performance gain. So how can I use scheduling to coalesce something, or to be a little bit more specific? Let's first start with what is coalescing. So coalescing is buffering or collecting a series of events together into one single emission. And this can happen in a specific time period. And in my time period, I want to collect or coalesce all of those synchronously emitted render calls. If I want to repaint my DOM, a lot of times it happens often in a row because different code executes synchronously on different places. And then I would have this very bad performance where I redraw the page multiple times in a row without any change to it. And this is why I want to implement and leverage coalescing to solve this first issue. So where will I buffer it? How much? Or how big is the time frame? I spoke about coalescing synchronous emissions. And if we speak about synchronous emissions and coalescing, you should know that microtask is the thing, the next thing you should Google. A lot of very specific tasks here, but it should be a quick overview of the presentation. So please excuse me when I don't go into detail for every single word here on the slide. But a microtask, just that you get the minimal needed information, is code or is a task that executes right after the synchronous code. So it is a synchronous code execution, but it is prioritized after the normal synchronous tasks. It's called a microtask. And I will use this small time duration between all the synchronous code and then the also synchronous code, but microtask, which is a very narrow time window, but I will leverage it and I will use the technique of coalescing to collect a lot of multiple emissions over a function. So here I have multiple emissions over time, and all those multiple emissions I want to pass into a function that does my coalescing. And this function basically should capture all the synchronous code, and after the synchronous code is done, it should render my screen only one time. And this basically looks like this. If I implement it, I schedule multiple rendering calls from this very region here, where I have the number 3. Then I pass all those calls into a function, use the small time window of a microtask to coalesce them together, and then I execute only one emission of this rendering. And this is pretty cool, and this is basically the essence and the very fundamental thing you need to do to either get high-performance applications or in another way, make zoneless applications possible in a way that scales in performance. Because normally, if you go zoneless and you just directly use, for example, detect changes, you will lose performance instead of gaining one. And this is one of the tricks that you should know if you want to leverage it. So let's talk about all my code examples and the package. I want to introduce you to high performance rendering, and the package here is called rxangular/template. It's out in alpha version, and we are pretty far to go into the next phase. So expect some very interesting and exciting changes in the future that I will already demo you today. Okay, so the first package, maybe quickly name it, is rxangular/state. This was part of my research from 2019 on component state, and this was needed to basically implement all the reactive glue that we can in the end leverage the performance in the template. So let's start over to rxangular template. What's included? I have several small building blocks. I have, for example, implemented imperative as well as reactive ways to render your template. And I also implemented some helper functions like the unpatch directive, where you could get rid of some global API that is zone patched by just applying this directive to your button clicks, inputs, and so on. And you can trick a zoneless environment in a zoneful application with only these few characters. Another thing that I created are rendering strategies. And this is really, really cool because this will include you as a community to not only benefit from the already explored techniques that we have here, but you can also give back and contribute with your own experiments and your own rendering strategies, because we want to expose rendering strategies in a service where you can register your own experiments, your own strategies. But let's skip to talk about rendering strategies, and let's talk about where we can use rendering strategies. So we can use rendering strategies in two different, let's say, units. One is a pipe that is called the push pipe, and the other one is at the moment the RX let directive, which basically gives you the same thing as a structural directive. These are the first two building blocks that we leverage, and expect a lot of more other reactive directives in the future. For example, think about a RX if, RX for, and RX switch. So basically the full template language in a reactive way. The last thing before I focus on those three here is the viewport priority. And this is basically an add-on on the let directive. So I can control if I render a specific part, a specific component, by looking at its visibility. And if this component is at the moment not visible because it is scrolled down and or out of the viewport, I cannot really use it. So let's focus on the push pipe and go on with the template syntax. A pipe is used as a pipe. I can add another parameter with a strategy. And here the let directive, where I can use the let syntax and a strategy to leverage, to bind an observable in this way into the template. And this is the way how I can leverage the rendering strategies. And I will jump now to these strategies and give you the first strategy, which is the global strategy. The global strategy is basically what Angular would do natively. It goes top to bottom and then, it goes bottom to top and then top to bottom and renders your application. We already know that this approach is not really optimum, the optimum, because we re-render unnecessary maybe those parts or even more parts of the application. But the good part of this strategy is it would also work zoneless, which is not possible with the normal async pipe or the normal strategies that Angular is using at the moment. And then with the knowledge of this part, I can talk about really performant rendering and how I used it. And let me quickly jump to the local strategy. This is the second main strategy that you should know. And this strategy is basically here to only render the very specific part that needs to get re-rendered, the list container and its list items, and not the rest. This is what, for example, great pioneers as Rob Wormald, for example, presented a couple of years, 1.5 to 2 years ago. And this is where we all try to head to leverage this part of the performance. But there are a couple of problems to go there. And I want to quickly sketch what I did to solve these problems and to implement those ideas from the past right now in our code base. To do this, let me quickly introduce a problem to you. I can render stuff in my component class, and I can render stuff in the template over the push pipe or the let directive. And if I use detect changes, which is the strategy that also works zoneless, I would have natively by Angular 12 renderings by just rendering one change to this component, which is a lot. And the goal is with our custom solution to get down to one rendering. And the problem is here that when I call render, every function either in the class or in the template has its own scope. And if I would try to coalesce this stuff, I would have to introduce a little bit of information maybe in the class, and then I could go down with the trick of coalescing and at least have the component for no matter how often I call render down to one single component. But I cannot go with this approach with directives. And here comes the really tricky part. The problem was I was in need of a specific thing or instance that is unique across the component class, the component template if you use a push pipe, or even the components, templates, directives if you use a let pipe. And I searched a little bit, and in the end, the solution was to use the component, the change detector reference.context, because this is equal no matter where you instantiate the CD ref. So this is a quick sketch of the trick on how I went down. And this basically made it possible to implement the local strategy, the first really, really cool implementation that I was able to ship and that now the full team of RX Angular is working on. And this is the local strategy, which is getting rid of those three axes at the bottom, at the top. So I really completely got rid of going up first and then try to re-render the full component tree. And the second thing is this dark green part on the right is only rendered once. So the number of components that get rendered reduced drastically. But also with coalescing and the trick of a micro task, I went down from 12 renderings with normal coalescing to 4 renderings. And with the trick of scoping the coalescing locally, like the principle of locality leveraged in a component, I went down to one single rendering. And I guess this is a really, really good thing and a performance improvement that I can already celebrate. But celebrating alone is boring. So let me quickly give you an intro of what's possible at the moment. And I do so by quickly check that this application is running in a zone full mode. So here we have zone enabled. And here I have the native strategy to render all this stuff. And the native strategy is basically identical to what the async pipe would do. And this is another proof why the async pipe is boring, to repeat it a little bit. So let me navigate to this application. And as you can see, there are small numbers. Let me refresh. There are these numbers that jump back and forth. And whenever I do something, my numbers basically change. And I see that renderings count up and down. And one very sad thing is if I change something in a child component, also the app component got re-rendered. And if you see the numbers 15 by only one click here, I jumped to 16 for the app component, also for all the other child components too. And this is one way to demonstrate bad performance. So what I could do here is I could switch the strategy globally to maybe local. And then we can see that, for example, if I search, let me first demonstrate this natively. I search something, and when I type, the renderings go up. And when the request, the result comes from the server, the renderings go also up. So typing, request. And this is interesting because why should I, if I only update this very component, also re-render my app component? So let's switch to the local strategy. And here I will do the same. Now I type request. But the request in this case only re-renders this very part here. So as you can see, the app component is not re-rendered all the time when the request arrives. Unfortunately, and this is a good demonstration why zone is your biggest enemy in a normal Angular application, even if you use the new rendering strategy, the principle of locality and coalescing and everything, you will cause re-rendering whenever you use an API that is patched by zone. Zone patches global APIs, and one of those global APIs that zone patches is add and remove event listener. And this is pretty annoying, because this means that here in our input box, we have an event listener to get the changes. And whenever I type a character, my event listener is firing. And as you can see, by only typing, there is no request, no HTTP request involved, but by only typing, I can render and re-render every single key down my whole application. And only the HTTP request focuses on re-rendering the very component where I am. So this is a very annoying, and therefore I came up with a quick and cool solution that is called the unpatch directive. And let me quickly apply it here. What unpatch basically does, it leverages a trick where I use the zone unpatched API, which is hidden under some symbols. And the unpatch could either take an input, an array where I can specify my events that I want to listen to, or if I don't specify any array, I automatically unpatch every event that is possible to fire on this input box here. It saves a little bit of lines of code if I do it this way. And if my application refreshes, I navigate for and back, I switch to local, and I scroll down and start to type in this very input box here. As you can see, no matter how fast I type, nothing happens to my application. And only if I stop and the request fires, only the bottom part here is updating. And this is really, really a great success if you just look at the number of renderings that you do for the full application unnecessary. This is done by using the push pipe and the let directive. And I talked a lot about zone is your biggest enemy and so on. Maybe let's ask the question, this is really nice. You run in an Angular application with zone and you got this cool performance gain by just adding a little bit of code, but what should I do to really move to a fully zoneless application? And the answer is pretty easy. Nothing else. Only implementing the pushpipe or the let directive and using the right strategy, for example, local is the most performance strategy, you can see that this application here runs fully zoneless. I can demonstrate it in, because I log console log here that I applied ng-zone noop. So zone is really excluded of this part here. And if I switch to the right strategy, we see that everything is working. I can search for stuff got my updates in the view and can navigate pretty much everywhere I want and introduce all the changes that I want. So by just using it in your normal application, you can, if you like, try out your code base in a zone-less way, and then you will see how far you can go with that approach. Another cool demo is we now went down for rendering and re-rendering the application hundreds and thousands of times to down to one-time coalescing and scheduling. Another cool trick that we could do is we can respect the viewport, and we can say a component that is visible should update. Whenever I click the button here, we see the number increases. And a component that is outside of my viewport, if I do anything, should not update. And only if it comes back to the viewport, it updates again. To really demonstrate you the power, imagine you have real-time applications and you have some updates here. I fire very frequently updates. It is that frequent that this blue animation turns really to a blue circle. But as you can see, they are running very, very fast. And if I scroll out with this component of my viewport, we see that the rendering stopped, and now even if my tick is running and even if the process or the app is receiving real-time changes, I don't do anything until I move back into the viewport and then I start rendering again. We are also safe if I jump to the number, 6181 here, and I scroll out of the viewport and I do some changes by clicking the count up button. You may say, well, I lost some state here, and now this component is outdated if it comes back. Not a problem, because if I scroll back, rendering flashes, I update the component, and I'm now at 6216. So I really jumped a lot of numbers more. What if I scroll out and back in with the same number? Should it re-render? Maybe no, because there is no change, right? So I scroll back, and there is no flash of re-rendering here. Only if I count up and then go back, it should flash. So I count up several times, I go back, and it flashes. This is viewport priority, a very, very quick demo. And now I have, I guess, 1 minute left. Let me quickly go to scheduling and to blocking UIs. And let me show you what a blocking UI is. I have these boxes here. These are 10 boxes. In these 10 boxes are 10 lines of text. And if I click this button here, I update the 10 boxes. As you can see, the number increases in those 10 boxes. And if I record the stuff and I click the 10 boxes a lot of times in a row, and I stop and I take a look at our flame charts, I can notice something. And if I quickly take a look, I see all those red boxes here. And if I zoom in, I can see, let me reduce the size a little bit. Yeah, I can see that I have in one task more work to do than a browser tick takes. And so I have blocking UI. This means your screen freezes and you cannot do anything. And this is the stuff we want to avoid. We don't want to have this red bar charts here. So let me introduce you one of the really, really cutting edge things we do. We introduced chunked scheduling. So we say, you give us the work, we calculate the amount of time you need for this work, and we chunk it into pieces that would fit into one browser animation frame tick. And then the rendering happens after another chunked. And you can see that if I click this button here, the flickering is different than I click the top one. This is chunked and after another, and this is all by one. I know the difference is not that visible, so let me record it, and I click 1, 2, 3 times the update, all-in-one button, and now I click 1, 2, and 3 times the animation frame, the chunked rendering button. And if the process is done, I can show you that we have some red bars here on the left, which is basically the button clicks that I did where I rendered everything on once. And we have, if we scroll here, Let me quickly zoom out. And we have here our renderings. And as you can see, there is only one single blocking task here. So we reduced it really a lot. And you can analyze those things over the red charts here. As a last thing to really demonstrate blocking UI and what it means to your user interface, because this is a really, really tiny application, let me give increment a number here to, let's say, 100. So I have now 100 boxes. And let me do a last demo, and then I'm really done. Sarah, I'm sorry for taking 1-2 minutes longer. I have 100 boxes now. If you realize, if I click on this box here, or if I click on this number here, there is an animation flashing. Now let me click the update child blocking, so all in one. I click it, and now they are here. I click it, and now they are here. In between, I can click the animation stuff, and nothing has happened. Click it, click, click, click. Hard to demonstrate. Let me increment it a little bit more. Let's make it a 300. Then we should really see how blocking UIs work. And bam, now I have 300. I click the all-in-one rendering. It takes, and now we have a render. I click it, and now we have a render. And now let me click the chunked one so that you really can see how amazing this performance improvement is. I click the chunked one, and they update, and the chunked one, and they update. So by using this chunk scheduler, I can reduce blocking UIs. You basically really have to pick when you want to use it and when not. But the cool part is all the features that I showed you are configurable with strategies, global strategies, strategies by component, and strategies even by single template helpers. And this is, I guess, a very, very nice view and roadmap that we have to our future explorations of this package. The package, again, RX Angular high performance rendering in your applications. Also component level state management is the second package. And to save your time, let me say thanks that you took your time, that you listened to me, that I was able to show you the latest discoveries, and that I can give you a sneak peek in what you can expect in the next weeks from the RX Angular template package. Whew. I'm done. I will stop screen sharing, and I will wait for Sarah to come back. So now we have basically the Q&A session, and there is also already one Q&A, one message here. Let me quickly read. Interesting if fake async works for zoneless Angular components. You mean for testing? Well, yes, because in the normal tests, you use the detect changes on the fixture, on the component fixture. Let's say in a normal testing setup, you use the component fixture to trigger those tests. And you basically not really rely on zone in tests. If you do more real life examples, maybe you render them outside of the default testing setup, or you really try to do some other tests, you could do this, and they should painlessly work in any application that has zone included or not. Basically, one of the cool things of this package, how we treated zone. Why is it cool the way we treated zone? Well, pretty much everybody out there treated zone so far in terms as zone is here or is not here, but I always use this ng-zone service to detect if zone is here or not. So I always depend on zone, and I always have to use this API. And if zone is here, I just use run outside of zone. Well, run outside of zone enables you to not trigger a change detection when you execute this code, but it also adds another layer of executions on top of your already huge task. So unfortunately, I have some screenshots here. Let me quickly jump to things so that you can really see what it means to how to deal differently with zone. I have Profile click. Ah, okay, cool. There we go. This should be an image. Ah, no, this is a profiling thing. I should have images that show me. It's not here. Unfortunately, the images are not here, but otherwise I could share the screen again and show the images, but you get really rid of a lot of code if you treat zone in the right way. And I totally forgot how to treat zone in the right way. You don't say run outside of zone. You go to the window and you ask for underscore underscore zone dash symbol underscore underscore your API name. And if you find anything there, this is the unpatched API. Take it, use it. If it is not there, zone was not present. So this is the trick how you can use zone. There are more comments. Nice. How do you unpatch on the fly? Well, unpatch the directive basically also works like that. I have a directive. The directive basically takes the host, which is any HTML element that you use or any component that is leveraging the click binding. It takes it and then it looks to its listeners. This is basically an internal browser thing where all the registered event listener functions are stored. And if I recognize that there is a function listening for something, I unregister the function, so nothing will happen anymore. And then I take the zone unpatched version and register the function again. This is done only one time when the component bootstraps, and then basically you're unpatched and you can do whatever you want and don't cause those over-rendering. Basically, the input, the unpatch for input bindings is one of the most interesting things because you have to know all the code base and all the examples are basically explored in real life projects. So performance optimizations that I did on large scale applications. And you might not know, but an input box can really mess up all the performance because if you have a very, a component with very bad performance above it in the components tree, and you have an input box below it as a child, for every input, for every key down, you will re-render this parent component again, even with change detection on push. And then you are basically, yeah, out of the game and your performance is gone. This thing does prevent if you just type since every time. Okay, this was just an answer, I guess. To the mess handling and just zone stuff yourself outside of Angular libraries, you are on your own way. Okay, so there is a very interesting one. There is a comment that says, if I want to handle my application yourself with ngZone stuff, I can shoot myself in the foot. As you can see, the demos, they are already running and they run zone less and zone full. Why is it no problem? Basically, one main thing is that I really don't care what Angular is doing with ngZone. I basically just take a look at the browser APIs that are patched. And if they are patched, I unpatch them myself. And the second part where it is really, really hard to maintain, let's say, a fully zoneless application is how you detect your change, how you trigger the re-rendering. And a very naive, or let's say the first thing that I did was I implemented the directives and the template, so I could use observables and RxJS to trigger the rendering, because every change for sure is notifying the push pipe, and then this is my trigger. More interesting is, how would you migrate an existing code base that is not reactive to a zoneless application? And of course, we also have solutions for this. This was basically the first thing the bigger companies demanded. They wanted a way to trigger rendering in their components over a function call with the same performance optimizations that we could leverage over the directives, speaking of coalescing, scheduling, and all this stuff. And there are also imperative functions present in this package that you can use to basically trigger your change detection whenever you introduce a new change. Okay, I guess I have some more minutes left, so let me scroll down to the next question. Earlier it was something at your company, we do something very similar by using detect change. Ah, okay, so they say at their company they're running some similar things, and they use detect change. Yes, you can do it, but if you want to scale, detect change will basically not work for you, because if you have multiple emissions synchronously, like multiple changes in a row, or multiple changes in parallel into different pipes, directives, or templates, or whatever, they will re-render unnecessarily, and this could have really, really bad performance impacts. So I could suggest just copy-paste the two function snippets that we have in the repository, implement it in your own code, and you're good to go. This should not stop community from... Okay, well, I believe I can switch the chat to Twitter and see if I have any DMs here. There was one maybe interesting one, but before the call, I'm not sure. Sarah, you're online. Yeah. Okay, so time is over, I guess.
We actually have a little bit more time. We have a question here, and I will just pop it up on the screen. How does it behave with third-party libraries that rely on Zone.js?
Yeah, this is a very, very good question. If you use Engine Material, which is like a very broad used library and a third party library, you will run into a couple of problems. A lot of the material code is relying on Zone microtask exhausted, on Zone other stuff, on some Zone triggers. And we basically did two approaches there. One approach was that we basically applied directives that we will not publish because it is just a hack. We applied directives that will trigger, for example, if you have an animation on focus, they will also trigger change detection when you focus the stuff. So we basically patch it from the outside, which I would not really recommend. So it is really for things like web components. Web components is a good example where you should leverage zone-less applications, otherwise zone-less code, because otherwise you always interfere with the main application zone, and then you have these two instances of zone, and the changes are not re-rendered. The common problems. So with elements, this is a thing you should try. A second thing was that we forked the code and replaced the Zone.js stuff from Material Package to just see how hard it is to refactor the components, maybe to contribute to the Material Package and see if they accept the contributions and work in a way where they not rely on Zone. Basically, the full component set of Angular Material is refactorable. We did it already, and we will maybe publish the refactored set of components in an experimental folder. And the next thing with other third-party libraries other than Material, well, normally if they are old and they are not reactive, you have hard times. So this is really something that I would not recommend. What I would do, and what basically all the bigger companies did that we helped so far, was keeping Zone in the project. So third-party stuff will work, but they leverage the local strategy, coalescing, scheduling, and also this unpatch stuff, so that they really reduce the re-rendering at the minimum. And in this case, we had like pretty much not a single blocking screen left, and we could keep Zone.js in the bundle. So Zone less performance with Zone full applications. And I guess this is also satisfying some other claims in the chat about you shoot yourself in the foot. I will just say, download the package, keep Zone inside, and just enjoy the performance right now. This was the question. Next one, Poke the Angular team. What was this Poke the Angular team with this feature request? Well, I'm in discussion with Minko on that stuff for quite some time, and it's an interesting thing. It is just on a roadmap very, very far away to get this natively into Angular, because a couple of other things need to be done. I have no clue when this will happen, but it's definitely on the roadmap. So local change detection and also the option to work zoneless is on the roadmap and is also now available in, for example, the Theta version of Theta Mark 30 is working without zone in comparison to Mark 4 check. So parts are done, but I believe it will take, it will not ship tomorrow that we can run the stuff that I have as a package now natively in Angular. But you can install the package all the time. If there is no other question, a big shout out to the other people contributing on this package, especially the two most favorite core team members, Julian Jandl and Kirill. They basically help a lot. They contribute with a lot of cool new ideas and a lot of cool code. And it's really, really a pleasure to work together in such a cool community. So thanks again for all those people that helped make these changes possible. Sarah, what
Yes, it looks like we do now? One more question. We have about 10
minutes. More.
One more question.
Does viewport directive improves performance in zone JS apps? For sure. Think about the following stuff. You have a very big application. You have multiple tables. You have everything. And you update something that is not visible. So if you apply that strategy, the noob strategy, which is basically not doing anything, this strategy is applied to all components that are outside of the viewport. And if you do nothing, nothing will happen. So all the features that I showed you work in zone full applications. If you disable zone, you can just remove a little bit of template stuff. For example, the unpatch directive is not needed anymore, and other stuff that you could do with, that you could have an overhead with zone is also not needed anymore. But the most safest way and the quickest way to get this incredible cool performance is by just keep zone in the package and leverage the features that we suggest here to increase the performance.
All right, I think that is all our questions for now. If you have any further questions, everyone, just feel free to get a hold of Mikhail on Twitter.
Yeah, my DMs are open on Twitter, so always shoot me a message.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your time, and we appreciate all of you tuning in.
Cool. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.